how many of you came to church this morning expecting to sing Christmas songs? But it's really funny to me because, you know, Christmas songs are not really Christmas songs. They're worship songs that have been hijacked by the commercialism of Christmas, right? And so when you think about the words and the lyrics to many of those songs, whether you like them or not, right, a lot of them are just very rich and deep in theology. But let me ask you a question. Let's have a little bit of honesty together this morning. I know it's church. We don't always do that. But let's try it and see what happens. How many of you put your Christmas tree up this weekend? Like you're an after Thanksgiving kind of folks. You're like, okay, Thanksgiving and then the Christmas tree. Okay, let's get real for a minute. How many of you put it up before Thanksgiving? Like you went ahead. Oh my goodness. Let's find out who the psychos are. How many of you put it up in October? Okay. Right over here, my wife. Yeah, she raised her hand. We used to have a rule, my rule used to be, look, after Thanksgiving. The tree can go up after Thanksgiving. Let's one holiday at a time. Let's go at it like that. And then we got married, and that rule went out the window. So it goes up earlier and earlier every year, I feel like. And so I think what I would prefer to do is we just leave it up and we just decorate it for each season. Like, just leave a tree in the middle of our living room. Like, that's fine, right? Okay, so we're good. There we go. Don't have to take the tree down this time next year. But we put ours up. There are some things that I love about the Christmas tree, and one of the things that I really do love about the Christmas tree is I love the lights on the Christmas tree. I love to turn the lights on early in the morning and have my coffee and read and have that light on early in the morning. But I don't know if you're aware of this or not, but I don't know if anybody knows who invented Christmas tree lights and when they were invented. Like they've actually been around for quite a while, but Christmas tree lights were invented in 1882 by the Edison Electric Company, right? And so, but here's the interesting thing about that is before Christmas tree lights invented by the Edison Electric Company, they just put candles on trees. I feel like that was a bad idea. And I don't think it took them very long to figure that out either. It's like, maybe we should not have done this, right? So I don't recommend that for anybody to do that. But there's something, if you think about it, really, there's something, at least for me, there's something magical, I think, about the lights and about those lights on the Christmas tree. One of my favorite moments that we've had here at the Ridge was actually just last year. I don't remember if it was the first or the second Sunday of Advent. So some of you were here, but we were in here and we had the candles lit, and all of a sudden the power went out. Yeah, so some of y'all remember that. The power, it was in our 9 a.m. service, and the power went out, and so there was nothing but just the candlelight, and so I had to preach by candlelight. That was the only way that I could see my stuff in my Bible. And so, but it was a powerful moment, right? It was Matt, the light, I think, really just kind of made that. Or even like here coming soon when we have our Christmas services on December the 22nd, one of the things that we do at our Christmas services is we light candles, and there, this whole room is lit up by candles, and we sing Silent Night together, looking at the light of the world, who is Jesus. Now, I don't know if you're like me or not, but I used to be one of those people who was just like, you know, Christmas lights are just like blah, you know? I mean, whatever. I mean, they're lights, you know? I mean, some are red, some are blue, some blink, some don't, some are white, you know? Like, Like, just, they're just lights. Like, if you've seen them, you've seen them, right? And so maybe you look at that and you're not one of those people who's like, hey, let's go look at the lights. Let's go look at the Christmas lights. Let's go to, you know, to the park and walk through the lights and do all those things. Maybe you're not that person. Maybe you are that person. But I used to be the person that was just like, it's kind of like fireworks. It's like, I don't really care. Like, they're just lights. Like, it does not affect me one way or the other. And then a couple of years ago, I was reading a devotional, a Christmas devotional, Advent, and I was reading about the light and about the power of light and talking about, like, just some of the scientific things around light and about God creating light and then Jesus being the light. And then, like, when I put all of those things together, when I look at the lights now, I see it differently. I don't just see Christmas lights anymore. I see the light. I see Jesus as the light. And that makes all the difference in the world for me. And so with all the imagery of lights around Christmas, we would be missing out if we didn't understand really what it all means, right? And I think sometimes we forget and need reminded. So that's what this series is all about, rediscovering Christmas. It's about reminding us of the deeper meaning of things that we may overlook during this season, like the light of Christmas, like we'll look at today. But lights are not just decorative. That they have this deep symbolic meaning, especially this time of year. And I don't need to remind you of this. Most of you know this, but we live in a dark world. Like there is darkness all around us. And darkness really is the context of Isaiah chapter 9. And so if you have a Bible with you, we're going to be in Isaiah chapter 9, referring to that most of the time. But to understand the context of Isaiah chapter 9, and it'll be on the screen so you can follow along there. If you have your YouVersion Bible app, you can open that up and follow along there. But darkness is the context, and so you have to go back to Isaiah chapter 7 and look at 7 and 8 to really get the context to understand what the prophet Isaiah is talking about in chapter 9. Now, we won't read all the passages there from all the way back to 7, but let me just summarize it for you. There's the king of Judah, Ahaz, and Ahaz is facing a threat. The whole kingdom of Judah is facing a threat from the alliance of the northern kingdom of Israel and Syria, and so Ahaz considers seeking out an alliance with the Assyrians to help them rather than trusting God, even though God's message to them over and if you read the book of Isaiah, the message to them has been over and over and over again, God saying, trust me, not man. Trust me, not man. And so the prophet Isaiah, and this is what Isaiah is a prophet, so he hears from the Lord and he speaks that word to the people, and this is what he's telling them. And so he urges Ahaz to trust God rather than make any kind of political alliances. And yet Ahaz refuses to do that. But the whole time that he's doing that, God is saying just, hey, let me give you a sign. And Ahaz is saying, I don't need a sign. And again, I'm just paraphrasing here what's happening in the book of Isaiah. And so Ahaz refuses to ask for a sign, but it's really funny, like the way that he refuses that is it really just kind of masks his unbelief as humility. He's like, oh God, I mean, you're so great, you're so wonderful, you're so powerful. I don't need a sign from you to know that I need to trust you. But yet the whole time, he's not. So God says, you know what, I'm going to give you a sign anyway because you need it and you're not paying attention. And so the prophet Isaiah speaks these words and says this in Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. It says, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. You're not asking for it. You're not looking for it, but I'm going to give it to you anyway. See, the virgin will conceive, have a son, and name him Emmanuel. And so understanding the context when Isaiah gives this word to them and says that there will be a son who is given to you and his name will be Emmanuel. What does Emmanuel mean? God with us. Isn't that the message that they needed? God is with you. God will be with you. But ultimately, what happens is destruction comes to Judah. but God promises his presence and ultimate protection, ultimately his protection. And Ahaz's job, he had one job. His one job was to let the people know that God was going to be with them and that they could trust God. And so when you get to Isaiah chapter 8, the message is clear. God says to them, trust me. Don't trust anyone else but me. But they don't. And so when you get to the end of Isaiah chapter 8, because of their lack of trust, you get this depiction of the people and what's happening in Judah at the time. And so Isaiah chapter 8, verse 21 says this. It says, they will wander through the land, dejected and hungry. When they are famished, they will become enraged, and looking upward will curse their king and their God. They will look toward the earth and see only distress, darkness, and the gloom of affliction, and they will be driven into thick darkness. So it paints a picture that is not very warm and fuzzy. Douglas Moo is a commentator and theologian, and he ties this darkness to spiritual rebellion. He says this, he says, darkness is not merely ignorance, but a moral condition, a deliberate suppression of the truth about God. The darkness Isaiah describes is the inevitable result of humanity's choice to trust in themselves rather than in God. And I think he's spot on describing what's happening there in those three chapters is the people of Israel just saying, hey, you know what? We got this. We can do this. We don't have to go to God. We can go to, as what Isaiah, if you back up a little bit in Isaiah chapter 8, says that they start going to spiritual mediums, right? People that are so-called astrologer experts. Hey, we've got it figured out for you. This is what you need to do. And so they're trusting in themselves. They're trusting in others. They're going here. They're going there. But they're not going to God, who's God is saying, hey, come to me. Trust me. I've got you. And so the result of that is darkness, spiritual darkness, a land filled with spiritual darkness. I think it may have been last year, or maybe the year before last. I can't really remember, but it was springtime, and we're sitting at home one evening, and a thunderstorm had came through, and we're sitting there, and all of a sudden, like the loudest clap of thunder and biggest flash of lightning I'd ever seen in my entire life, and I mean, shook the whole house. You remember that? It felt like a bomb blew up in our basement, and so. Lightning had struck our house, and so power went out, but immediately, like, the power in the rest of the, like, most of the rest of the house came back on, like, just a few moments after that, but there was a part of our house, like, certain rooms where there was no power. Like, we'd go to flip the light switch, and there'd be no power, but other parts of the house, there was power on, and so, like, I did what everybody probably who is not an electrician would do, is I went to YouTube. And I was like, I gotta figure this out, right? Somebody on YouTube knows, right? Which, when you think about it, is really not the smartest idea, right? Like, especially when you're dealing with electricity. Like, there's some guy who's like, well, I mean, I got lucky and figured it out, and I shot a video, and so here you go. This is what I did. It's like, oh, let me try that, right? Not a good idea. And so for days, like, I'm trying to figure, like, I'm watching these videos, I'm reading stuff, I'm trying to figure stuff out. And so I'm thinking that, you know, it's in our breaker box because I go and flip the breaker and it kept flipping, you know, kept tripping. Like, we would flip it and it would be okay. And then at some point during the day, like, it would trip again. And we couldn't figure it out. And so for days, like, we're just trying to figure this out. And so finally, instead of me going, you know what, I can do this, I can fix this, I got this, I called somebody who knew what they were talking about. I called an electrician, and I had them come. And they came, and they started, like, just through a process of elimination, like, checking different things out. And what they had found was something that I never would have found myself. There was a ground wire from the lightning strike that had gotten knocked loose. And every time the light switch that was connected to that ground wire got turned on, it tripped the breaker. I never would have known that. I never would have figured that out. It looked like it was attached, but it was just barely hanging on. And it was a fire hazard. So there's that too, right? So not only that I didn't know, but it was also dangerous. But I mean, isn't that us today? Things are dark, and we just go, you know what? I can fix it. I can take care of this. I can do this. I don't need anybody else to tell me what to do or how to do it. I don't even need God, really. Like, and we wouldn't say that necessarily out loud, but our actions show it. I think the great fallacy of our time is that whatever truth we produce for ourselves, within ourselves, is the one that will overcome the darkness around us. We think that, we believe that we can create our own world of light and peace. And so what has happened is that we have become our own little gods of our own little worlds, and we forget that we are not God, and that we need the real God of the universe to chase away the darkness in this world. And so we will never find our way with the darkness around us. We'll never find our way unless Jesus is our light. And maybe that explains the plight of some of us. We've turned to everyone and everything to find our way in this life, and yet we feel more lost, more helpless, more hopeless than we ever have before, because nothing has worked. And so if Isaiah chapter 8 tells us the problem, then Isaiah chapter 9 tells us the solution. Look at the very next words of Isaiah chapter 9, verse 1. So in 22 of chapter 8, it says, "There will only be distress and darkness and the gloom of affliction." And then in verse 1 of chapter 9, it says, "Nevertheless." So coming right after that, it's like, hey, there is darkness everywhere. We'll be surrounded by darkness. However, there is hope. Nevertheless, he says, "The gloom of the distressed land will not be like that of the former times when he humbled the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the future he will bring honor to the way of the sea, to the land east of the Jordan, and to the Galilee of the nations." And if you want to see that prophecy fulfilled, again, this is hundreds of years before the coming of Christ, you want to see that fulfilled, go read Matthew chapter 4. Then in verse 2 it says this, "The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. A light has dawned on those living in the land of darkness. You have enlarged the nation and increased its joy. The people have rejoiced before you as they rejoice at the harvest time and as they rejoice when dividing the spoils. For you have shattered their oppressive yoke and the rod on their shoulders, the staff of their oppressor, just as you did on the day of Midian. For every trampling boot of battle and the bloody garments of war will be burned as fuel for the fire." And then verse 6, this promise. Again, "For a child will be born for us. A son will be given to us. And the government will be on his shoulders. He will be named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. And the dominion will be vast. And its prosperity will never end. He will reign on the throne of David and over his kingdom to establish and sustain it with justice and righteousness from now on and forever. The zeal of the Lord of armies will accomplish this." And so what I want to do this morning is I want to share quickly three things today to help us just rediscover the light of Christmas. And the meaning of the light of Christmas. And so when the prophet Isaiah says that the people walking in darkness have seen a great light, what does that mean for us? And so the first thing is this, is that the light of Christmas is a shock to the soul. It is a shock to the soul. A couple of years ago, it was probably 3:30, 4 o'clock in the morning, and was dead asleep, as one should be at that time. Was asleep, and all of a sudden, I remember just being jolted awake, like shocked awake, because there's this loud beating of my front door at like 4 a.m., you know, just. And like anybody, I just jump up, right? I'm up, awake. It's like fight or flight. It's like, what's going on? Like, what's happening? Who's beating on the door? And I go into the living room where the front door is, and there is this bright light shining through the door. Like, half the door is like glass and like a pixelated glass, so you can't really see out of it. But there's this light, this bright light coming through the front door and a beating on the door, and I'm blinded by this light. And again, I like just jolted awake, have no idea what's going on. Like, you know, and I'm just like stumbling around like, what is happening? And so I go to the window and look out the window, and I see a police car in my driveway with the lights on. And so I kind of peek around and look, and sure enough, there's a police officer standing at the front door with a flashlight shining in my door, beating on the door like he's the police, because he is. And so I go to the front door, and I open the door, and I'm like, you know, what's going on? Can I help you? He's like, yeah, somebody here at this home called 911. I'm like, wasn't me. I was asleep. Like, I have no idea. Like, and so I'm like, you know, thinking, I'm like, okay, kids are safe. They're good. They're upstairs. Danero's in the bedroom. Like, I think we're good. I was like, nobody here called 911. He's like, yeah, we got a call of 911 here. I said, did anybody talk to you? He's like, no, it's just dead silence. I was like, I have no idea. I was like, I have no idea what you're talking about. And so, like, we talk about it, you know, and he's like, well, and here's the funny thing. Like, maybe this should be something that gets taken care of at some point. But he goes, so everybody good in here? Yeah, everybody's good. All right, great. See you later. So he leaves, right? I'm like, you might, like, maybe want to, I don't know, do I look like not a serial killer? Like, I don't have it. Like, everybody's fine, you know. Anyway, I'm thankful, though. It's 4 a.m. I'm like, you go back to sleep. And so I'm like, what in the world just happened? So I go back, and my phone is laying in the bed. Normally it's on the nightstand on the charger. It's laying in the bed, and I look at it, and sure enough, like, I like laid on top of it or something and made it do the emergency thing where it calls 911, and that's what happened. And so I was like, okay, it's my fault. My bad. I did it. I called 911. But how shocking it was to be woken up at 4 a.m. in the morning with a blinding light through the front door and a beating on the door, right? I mean, I was shook in that moment. But I think one of the things that we miss about Christmas is that the birth of Christ is and should be a shock to our souls, because his coming means that we needed a Savior. And many don't even know that we need one. If you ask most people, they would say that they don't think they need a Savior. We're doing just fine on our own. And so it's one thing to get that warm and fuzzy feeling that Christ has come, but why did he come? Why did he have to come? Because we needed a king to come and reconcile us to God. Like, if that doesn't shock you in some way, if that doesn't wake your soul up in some way, like, Christmas is great, and like, you know, all the fun holiday drinks and, you know, funny sweaters and this and that, like all the things, we need to not ever forget the fact that there would be no manger if there wasn't a cross. Tim Keller says that Christmas shows us that God came to pick a fight for our soul. And that's true, because we needed it. If there was no darkness, if there was no sin, we would not have needed God to send his only Son to rescue and redeem us and be the light in the darkness. And I think we need a shock to our souls this morning. Probably not what you expected, but the Christmas story is full of the unexpected. And like Christmas lights, we may need to rediscover the unexpected in the story so that we can truly feel the shock to our soul. I mean, when you think about like just the shock of that, not only like even if we think about it today, like right now, still should be shocking for us, but how shocking it would have been for them in the first century. If you think about it. I mean, Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world, God in flesh, was born in not just a small town. We're talking like podunk small town. They didn't even have a Hardee's. Like, that's how small it was, right? Like, every small town has a Hardee's, right? Not Bethlehem. He was not born in the religious headquarters of Jerusalem. The Savior was not born in comfort. He was laid in a feeding trough. That's what a manger is. It's a feeding trough for animals. He's not born into a middle-class family or a wealthy family, not surrounded by kings and queens and nobility, but surrounded by shepherds who were considered to be the lowliest of people. People that didn't get invited to Thanksgiving dinner. Nobody wanted the shepherds around. Born to an unwed teenage mother. Not to a king, not to a queen. The point is, Jesus was not born in a way that would make anyone go, hey, look at that right there. I see greatness right there in that manger. There's greatness. The King of the universe, there it is. Like, you can see it. It's written all over his face. No one saw it coming. God brought about the light and the darkness in a way that no one would expect. And so just like he may bring the light into your darkness in a way that you didn't see coming. And so when you really think about it, how shocking that is. And how shocking it should be to us. And so on one hand, Christmas wakes us up with this blinding light that says, hey, there's a problem. The people are in darkness. There is a problem. What is the one thing that shakes darkness and that moves darkness away? What is the one thing that does that? Light. There's a problem. There's darkness. There's darkness everywhere. What is needed? Light. But not just any light. And so here's what that light does. And so Christmas, the light of Christmas, first of all, should be a shock to our soul. But here's what that light does, is that secondly, the light of Christmas is revealing. And it reveals, I think, two things. There's probably more than that, but at least two things that I think it reveals to us. The first thing is this, is that it reveals to us who we are. In Luke chapter 2, Simeon calls Jesus, he says he is a light to reveal God to the nations. You ever driven your car without the headlights on? You ever done that? Like, you know, forgot to turn them on. Like, most of them now, like, you turn your car on, they're just automatically on. But for whatever reason, sometimes you just turn them off, need to turn them off, and you start to drive, and you're driving down the road, and, you know, everybody's flashing their lights at you, and you're getting mad. Like, you don't know why they're flashing their lights at you, you know, and it takes you a few moments to realize it, you know, pick up on it. But it's usually not until you get into a dark place, right, like, and you start to go, I can't see anything. And then you turn the lights on, and now you see everything, right? Because that's what the light does. The light is revealing. It shows us the way, and that's what it does. 1 John chapter 1, verse 5 and 6, John writes this. He says about Jesus, he says, this is the message we have heard from him and declare to you. God is light. And there is absolutely no darkness in him. And then he says, if we say that we have fellowship with him, and yet we walk in darkness, we are lying and not practicing the truth. So like even John says, he says, so God is light, but yet if we walk in darkness and we're surrounded by darkness and there is no light, you can't say that you have fellowship, that you are saved by him, that he is with you, because he is light. And if he is light and you are in darkness, there should be no darkness. The darkness should be pushed back because he is light. And so it shows us who we are. John Piper says this. He says that Christmas, first and foremost, is an indictment before it becomes a joy, because it reveals and shows us who we are. as Jesus is speaking to Nicodemus in John chapter 3, right? Like we all know John 3:16, right? For God so loved the world that he gave his only son that whoever believes in him will not die but will have everlasting life, right? This is a conversation that Jesus is having with a religious leader, a Pharisee who has come to Jesus and said, hey, I got some questions. But the interesting thing about John chapter 3 is when Nicodemus comes to Jesus, it says that he comes to Jesus in the night. Because he's got questions. And he doesn't want to be seen as someone who's hanging out with Jesus, because as a Pharisee, the Pharisees were not big fans of Jesus, right? But Nicodemus, he has had a shock to his soul. He sees something about Jesus that other people don't see. And so in part of this conversation, Jesus says this. He says, this is the judgment. The light has come into the world. And this is verse 19. He says, the light has come into the world, and yet people loved darkness rather than the light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone who does evil hates the light and avoids it, so that his deeds may not be exposed. But anyone who lives by the truth comes to the light, so that his works may be shown to be accomplished by God. See, God is the source of all truth. And it shows us who we are. The light reveals our sinfulness. It shows us that we are sinners and that we are in darkness and we need the light. And so it shows us who we are. But the other thing that light does is it shows us who he is. The incarnation, right? It means God put on flesh to be with us and amongst us. God became flesh. Jesus wasn't a human who became God. He was God who became human, but yet retained all of his godliness. 100% man, 100% God. This is the incarnation. The Word was with God. John says the Word was with God and the Word was God. But the beauty of the incarnation is that that's exactly what happened, is that God came down to us. How many of you work at home, like your office is at home? Like you got a home office, most of it's been, okay. So that number is dwindling a little bit. But some of us still work at home sometimes. I have an office at home. I work at home sometimes. Sometimes I'm here at the office at church. But when our kids were younger, like they would usually play like down in the basement. I'd be in the office upstairs, and they'd be down in the basement, and they'd play. Maybe they'd have kids over or something like that. But if you have younger kids and you have kids at home and you're trying to work, and they start to get a little rowdy, they start to get a little loud, right? Maybe they start to argue with each other. Like there's a process that we kind of go through as parents, right? It's like the first thing that you do is you yell down at them and you say, "What is the problem?" Right? Why are we arguing? Why are we fighting? Why are we yelling? Why is it so loud? And then they start to explain. And you ain't got time for that. Ain't nobody got time for that, right? And so you just say, fix it. Right? Like, just fix it. And then it continues, right? As it does. And so it continues to go. They continue to not get along or argue or just be loud or whatever, and you're trying to concentrate and you're trying to work, and so you get up and you yell down again. If you don't fix it, I'm coming down there. Do they fix it? No. And so what do? You go down there. Right, and this is Jesus. This is God. God said, there's a problem. I've got to come down there. Because the only way to fix it is for me to come down there. And so I'm coming down there. And so God comes. That is the beauty of Christmas, is that God has come. And he has come down. He put on flesh to come down to be with us and amongst us and for us. Only God himself could save us. He didn't send someone else. He didn't say, you know what, let me try to find a good human down there that can take care of this problem, and I'll send them. He said, no. I'm coming myself. John chapter 1, verse 4, John writes this about Jesus. He says, in him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and yet the darkness did not overcome it. Only Jesus could be what Isaiah says here in Isaiah chapter 9, verses 4 through 6. Only God could be those things. Only God could be wonderful counselor, mighty God, eternal Father, Prince of Peace. Only God could be those things. So the light of Christmas shows us who we are. That we are sinners in the darkness. But it reveals who He is. He is the light in the darkness. And then last, I'll close with this. The light of Christmas demands a response. It's a little bit, it's not entirely bright in here. It's a little dim in here. But when you walk out of these doors out there, like, you're going to walk out and it's really bright out there, right? And so when you walk out of here and you walk out there, like, or if we were to, like, turn on all the lights in here all at once, like, you would probably, like, be like, you know, like, you'd kind of squint a little bit and, you know, look back and it'd be a little, especially right here with these lights, like, it would blind me, you know? I was thinking about this, like, as I was, the other day, but, like, you know, when you go to the beach, like, if you're at the beach, and, like, when we go to the beach, we typically go to the Gulf Coast, and there's, you know, white sand and clear water, and so when the sun, and there's no clouds, the sun is really bright, like, it's just really bright out there. Like, I can't walk out onto the beach without sunglasses. I don't know. And then I look at my kids, and they're just like this, with no sunglasses. Like, walking around, like, the whole day, no sunglasses, and I'm like, what is wrong with you people? Like, how do you do that? And I take my sunglasses, I go out there, and I take my sunglasses off for 5 seconds, so I'm just like, I can't, I need sunglasses. But that's what light does, right? Like a bright light like that, it demands a response from you. Like, you'll respond when the light is bright. When I was a kid, my mom, like, when I would wake up for school in the morning, my mom would come and she would wake me up. And the difference between the way my mom would wake me up and the way that my dad would wake me up were, like, two different worlds. I don't know if you experienced this or not, but, like, my mom would come in, she wouldn't turn the light on, she'd walk over to me, she'd tap me on the shoulder, you know, she'd very nicely, compassionately, you know, hey, wake up, it's time to go to school, you know, like, do that whole thing. Not my dad. My dad would walk in, flip the light on, time to get up, yank the covers off the bed, right? Like, just no compassion whatsoever. It's like, you know, might as well just throw water on my face, right? Like, I mean, it's just totally different, right? But you know what? You have a choice in that moment. You either pull the covers up over your head or you get up. With my dad, I would suggest not pulling the covers up over your head because it's just only going to get worse from there. And so you respond, but that's what you do, is you respond to the light. And when you read the scriptures, when people encountered Jesus, they responded. They responded one way or the other. They responded. They either responded by falling to their knees and worshiping Him or walking away from Him. You didn't just like Jesus. You didn't just look at Jesus and be like, I mean, He's a pretty cool guy. I like Him. He's all right. No, He demands a response because this is what light does. Again, in John chapter 1, verse 10, John says, He was in the world. And the world was created through Him, and yet the world did not recognize Him. He came to His own, and His own people did not receive Him. And so the people who met Jesus in the Scriptures, they either ran to Him or they ran away from Him. In fact, the coming of Christ creates a conflict for our soul. Think about this, because we are forced to choose one way or the other, to either come to him or to run from him. And in Luke chapter 2, verse 32, Simeon, as Jesus is being presented by his parents in the temple, Simeon says this. And so imagine, if you will, for a moment, Simeon, the priest, who is speaking to Mary, holding her baby boy, Jesus. And she's been given these promises. She's been given these prophecies and has been told who he is. And what does it say that Mary does? Mary says that she treasures these things. But listen to these words. I'm going to read to you Luke chapter 2, verse 32, and I'm going to read it to you from the New Living Translation, because I just love the way that this paraphrase of Scripture paints this picture for us. And it's not the warmest of Christmas texts. Nobody's talking about this text at Christmas. But here it is. It says this. It says, "He is a light to reveal God to the nations, and he is the glory of your people, Israel." Jesus' parents were amazed at what was being said about him. So, like, on one hand, they hear that and they're like, "This is amazing. Like, our boy, like he is a light to the nations, to reveal God to the nations. He's going to do amazing things." And then Simeon says this. Simeon blessed them, and he said to Mary, the baby's mother, "This child is destined to cause many in Israel to fall." Like, whoa, wait a minute, hold up, what? That doesn't sound great. And then he says, "And many others to rise. He has been sent as a sign from God, but many will oppose him. As a result, the deepest thoughts of many hearts will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your very soul." It's not a great Christmas text, is it? It doesn't feel that way. But Simeon's not wrong. Many will oppose him, but many will rise to see him for who he is. Jesus says in Matthew that he didn't come to bring peace, but a sword. Like, we forget that, right? And so when Jesus says that, are we saying that Christ doesn't, he's not peace, he's not the Prince of Peace, he doesn't bring peace? No. He is peace. If we have him, we can have peace. But what he's saying there is, he says, "I didn't come to bring peace, but a sword." He's saying, "I've come and there will be division, because you will choose. I'm either the light or I'm not. You will either see me as light or you will not. But make no mistake, I am light." And so when someone comes along and says that they are the King of Kings, you either have to reject that, run from it, or you fall to your knees in worship. And so encountering Jesus demands a response. I want you to notice verse 6 again. Verse 6 says, in Isaiah chapter 9, it says, "For a child will be given for us. A son will be given to us." Jesus is our gift if we receive him humbly by grace. I don't know if this happened to anybody else or not, but when I turned 18, my birthday is in November, and so like that first Christmas when I turned 18 was an odd one for me, because all the other Christmases before that, like my parents, like. My mom and dad would say, "Hey, make a Christmas list, put things that you want, fun things, games, and, you know, toys, whatever. Like, put that stuff on the list, and we'll get you some of those as gifts." And so up until, like, for 17 years, gifts were fun. And then I turned 18. I was asked for no list. I didn't get to put fun things on that list. You know what I got for Christmas, my 18th, when I turned 18? I got a pair of jumper cables, a car wash kit, and a toolbox. I was like, "What's the toolbox for? I don't own a house." My dad was like, "Well, you got to change your oil. There you go." Oh, and I think I got a couple of quarts of oil too. That's what I got, and a gift card to Home Depot, which now would be awesome. You know, it's like, that's great. I'll take that. Jumper cables weren't fun. Toolbox wasn't fun. Like, none of those things were fun. I didn't want those things, but I needed those things. And I didn't know I needed it at the time. I definitely needed the jumper cables because I left my, like, car lights on a lot, and that was back in the day. So anyway, never mind. It was sort of humbling and not fun, but they were right because I needed it. But you know what I did, like, receiving those gifts is I didn't look at those gifts and be like, oh, take these back. I don't want them. I don't need them. And you just receive them humbly with grace. You see, nothing will make us swallow our pride like the gift of Jesus to the world. And you see, if the world and you and I in this world were so bad and the problem of sin in this world was so dark that God had to leave the beauty of heaven to come down here into the mess and not just come down here but had to suffer and die on a cross, that must mean that things are really bad. But Jesus gives himself and salvation as a gift. A child has been given for us. For us. A light has dawned. A light in the darkness. And so when we look at the lights of Christmas this year, when you see candles at Advent, you see the lights on your Christmas tree, or you're driving by and you see somebody has lights on a house, whether they look great or they just look like somebody just went, you know. Like, look at those lights differently. Don't just see blinking lights or just like, lights, I've seen them. Just be reminded that of the light of Christmas. That it's a shock to our soul that we needed this light because of the darkness. That it shows us who he is. It shows us who we are. And that it demands a response. Charles Spurgeon once wrote this. He said, "If you are in the dark today, do not despair. The sun will rise and the shadows will flee away. Cling to the promises of God, for his light will surely break through." Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word this morning. Lord, we pray that, God, as we respond, Lord, that if we find ourselves in darkness this morning, God, that we would look to the light. God, to be reminded that we are light, or that you are light, God, and that we need the light. And if there is a shock to our system that is needed, God, that we are jolted by the light, God, that you would do so in only the way that you can. God, to help us and to show us, revealing to us who you are, who we are, and the need that we have with you, and that our response would be worship. To fall on our knees, God, to look to you as the light. The only thing that can help us, the only thing that can save us. The only path in the darkness. And it is you. It's in your name we pray.